Hi, this is Kim Eierman from EcoBeneficial, bringing you more useful gardening tips to help improve our environment. Today, I have the pleasure of interviewing Dr. Karen Oberhauser. Karen is a conservation biologist, professor at the University of Minnesota in the Department of Fisheries, Wildlife, and Conservation Biology. And probably more than anyone that I've ever encountered, Karen knows more about monarchs since she's been studying them since 1984. So welcome, Karen.
Thank you. It's great to be with you, Kim.
Well, this is a hot topic, obviously, and you've just done an amazing amount of work, lots of research publications. You've co-authored three books on monarchs, and I'm just going to mention them, Karen, because I want listeners to pick these up because I think they're really interesting. One of my favorite books, Milkweed Monarchs and More, A Field Guide to the Invertebrate Community in the Milkweed Patch. That's a marvelous book.
Well, thank you. It was a lot of fun to write that. That book started out, it was going to be a brochure. And then as we learned more and more about different things that were found in the milkweed patch, we thought this needs to be a whole book. So it was great to work on that.
The diversity of life in a milkweed patch is extraordinary. I just think this is an eye-opening book, so thank you for that. And then you also have a book, this may have been the first one that you co-authored, The Monarch Butterfly Biology and Conservation.
Mm-hmm. And that's a little bit more of a kind of a science-heavy book. That would be for people who really wanted to delve into the science of monarch biology.
Okay. And the third one, Monarchs in a Changing World.
Mm-hmm. And that one just came out last year, so we're pretty excited. That's got up-to-the-minute news on what's going on with monarch populations, what we know about them, about their diversity all over the world, and how we can help them.
Well, thank you for those contributions. I think they're all wonderful resources. And I found out a little factoid. I found out that you were named in 2013 a champion of change for citizen science by the White House. That's pretty cool.
That was a real honor. It really meant a lot to receive that award. It was exciting.
So I think we better pay attention to what you have to say, Karen, about monarchs. You're well qualified. Tell us a little bit about monarch biology. I mean, how do they live? What's their life cycle? How does this all work?
Sure. So monarchs have a really unique life cycle. There are other insects that migrate. Usually when people think of migration, they think of birds or whales or bigger animals than insects. So there are other insects that migrate, but monarchs have a very regular and predictable migratory cycle. So we often think of this migratory cycle as having four phases. The first phase is their breeding. So in the summertime, monarchs are breeding. If we think of the North American monarchs in the eastern half of the country, those monarchs are breeding in the northeastern quarter of the United States and southern Canada. They go through about three non-migratory generations. And then the last generation of the year is physiologically different than the ones that preceded it. Instead of starting to mate and reproduce soon after they emerge as adults, they migrate all the way through the United States. They funnel down through Texas and then fly through northern Mexico to get to overwintering sites in Mexico. So they have the stage of breeding and then a southward fall migration. And then the third phase is overwintering in Mexico. And they actually spend about 5 months really doing very little. They just hang out in trees in Mexico. At that point, the whole population or the vast majority of the population is together. So we can estimate their numbers. And then about now, in fact, last week, the monarchs leave these wintering sites in Mexico and fly back for the fourth stage of this migratory cycle, which is a spring migration.
And Karen, do they all leave at once?
Well, no. They leave within a fairly short period of time. So they start leaving probably, it varies from year to year. This year, it seemed like some were leaving about the 10th of March. Unfortunately, there was a terrible storm in Mexico after some of them started leaving.
I heard about that.
Yeah, the ones that didn't leave, we don't know how many were killed, but a lot were. And that just illustrates the fragility of this population. And when you have everything together, together like this, one bad weather event can really affect a big proportion of the population. Mm-hmm. So we'll see. We'll see what happened to them.
Because things had been looking a little bit more promising. It looked like they were covering more habitat in Mexico for this past winter, correct?
Yep. And, you know, in some ways, we're really lucky. We dodged a bullet, because if this storm had come last year or the year before, when the population was so low, losing, you know, it might be up to a third of them that were killed. Losing a third of a small number is a much bigger problem than losing a third of a larger number like we had this year. Mm-hmm. So it was a setback, but it could have been a lot worse. Mm-hmm. So then if we just finish this migratory cycle, so we've got them all together in Mexico where they're vulnerable to extreme weather events like this, those very same butterflies migrate back into the southeastern quarter of the United States. They lay eggs, those eggs develop, and then their offspring are the ones that come back into the northern United States. So while the fall migration is the same butterflies doing the whole trip, the spring migration to get back where they started takes an extra generation. The same mm-hmm. butterflies don't make it all the way back. And then there is, in North America, there's another migratory population. It's not completely distinct, but divided by about the Rocky Mountains. There's a population that goes through similar phases of an annual cycle, and they overwinter along the coast of California. Mm-hmm. But we do know that there are populations, for example, in Arizona, where some of those butterflies will actually migrate south to the overwintering sites in Mexico out of Arizona, and some of them migrate west to the overwintering sites along the coast of California. So there's some genetic interchange, some interchange of individuals and thus genes between these two populations. They're not genetically distinct.
That's fascinating.
It is.
Now, the population that overwinters in Mexico is quite a bit larger than those that overwinter in California. What are the numbers looking like now?
Well, it's hard for us to know exactly what the numbers are. And as you said earlier, in Mexico, we measure the area that they occupy because mm-hmm. it's really impossible. So we measure that area in hectares because it's in Mexico. So they use hectares instead of acres. This year, it was approximately 4 hectares. Mm-hmm. And we think that there are anywhere from 35 to 50 million monarchs in a hectare. So those 4 hectares could have been, you know, a couple hundred million monarchs.
Wow. Now, do you recall how large a hectare is? Because I was asleep during that class in school.
It's about 2.4 acres.
Okay.
So that's how you can do the translation.
All right. And not a lot of area, but a lot of butterflies.
Right. When mm-hmm. you think of that, if we had 4, and some of the years we were under 1 hectare. 2 years
wow.
ago, it was under 1 hectare. So that's not a very big area for all of the monarchs in eastern North America to cluster into. And it's not one contiguous mm-hmm. Area. They're actually occupying different mountains. Tops in the same general area, but it's not one big area that they're occupying. It's several different ones, depending on the year, anywhere from 9 to 12 different colonies
okay.
make up this overwintering population.
And there's a particular tree that they like, correct?
Yeah, it's called an Oyamel fir tree. So it's in the same genus as the fir trees that we have in the United States. It's a very close relative of like the Douglas fir in this country. And really, it's not that they're choosing that tree. That's just the tree that's most abundant
mm-hmm.
Where they end up. So what they're actually doing when they fly to these wintering sites in Mexico is looking for very specific climatic conditions. And these conditions are found relatively high in the mountains because they need to survive such a long time. It has to be pretty cool for them. If it was warmer, their metabolism would speed up and they wouldn't be able to stay alive for the entire winter. So basically, they're living off fat that they stored up as caterpillars and as adults when they were migrating. They ate a lot on the way down there. And they have to just kind of hang on and survive. And the cooler it is, the longer they can survive in Mexico. But if it's too cold, they'll freeze to death. So I like to say, to use the analogy, they're going to a refrigerator, mm-hmm. but not a freezer.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And that's what keeps them alive.
So it's interesting. So if that fir tree was endangered or threatened with an exotic invasive insect, monarchs would still have a prayer. Because I know they utilize, the ones in overwintering in California, utilize different trees like eucalyptus. I'm not sure what else, mm-hmm. but...
Eucalyptus and a lot of native pine trees. I mean, it's mm-hmm. kind of interesting because, but it illustrates the fact that they can adapt to different species because... Mm-hmm. Eucalyptus, of course, is not native mm-hmm. To North America, but they can use those trees. If something attacked the OML fir trees in the wintering sites in Mexico, there wouldn't be anything else growing there for a long time. So mm-hmm. it would be a problem for the monarchs. But yeah, it's they're just looking for the conditions, and they like the same conditions that the OML fir trees like.
And a lot of that habitat in Mexico in particular has been lost. What is going on there?
So, yeah, that land is all protected by federal law. So there's a big area that's protected by a decree, a presidential decree in Mexico. But it's a little different than protected land in this country. So in this country... we have very strong individual property rights. But in Mexico, the federal government can protect land that is still owned by the people. So the most of the acreage near where the monarchs overwinter is protected by a federal law, but the government doesn't own it. It's owned by people. So mm-hmm. there's some controversy there. There's, some of the people aren't happy about this, you know, their inability to cut down these trees. So mm-hmm. there is some illegal logging, but any logging that does occur in that area is not legal. It's people who do it are breaking the law. So
mm-hmm. interesting.
So you know, it still happens. It's slowed down a lot, but we had a bad event this year where there are about 10 hectares. So you can do the math. 24 acres mm-hmm. Were cut down very close to one of the areas where there are actually colonies of monarchs. So it still happens. You know, it's just like in this country. We have people that break the law.
Mm-hmm. What, do you happen to know, is there any consequence to that logging?
Well, the people that did it weren't caught.
I see.
So it's a vast area, and it's a mm-hmm. lot of these sites are kind of far from where people live. Mm-hmm. It does not occur when the monarchs are there. So there are more people in the area, a lot of tourists going there, a lot of people from the government that are monitoring these sites when the monarchs are there. But there's kind of less attention paid to them during mm-hmm. the summertime, and that's when this happened. It happened sometime between April and August, and we could tell that from satellite photos.
Wow. Are they replanting?
Well, that's a very interesting question. There's some controversy about whether it would be better to replant, because this logging occurred in a very pristine area, and bringing in the machinery and the people to replant trees and bringing in trees that where the seeds maybe came from a different area might not be as good in the long run as waiting for this to naturally regenerate. So there's quite a lot of discussion and talk and some research going on about what will be the best thing to do in this area.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's quite fascinating. Now, one role that you also play beyond being a professor at the University of Minnesota is you're the director of the Monarch Lab. Mm-hmm. And I'm very interested in that. It appears to be a way that you're getting your research out to the public, correct?
Yeah, the Monarch Lab is at the University of Minnesota, and we have about 15 people right now working in the Monarch Lab. And we really have three main roles. So a lot of people are doing research, and that's both graduate students and undergraduates and me, who are working on research from many aspects of monarch biology. Most of us are doing work that's pretty focused on conservation. We also do a lot lot of outreach. So we have courses for teachers. We do a lot of work with citizen science where mm-hmm. we engage the public in studying monarchs, and they're learning about monarchs at the same time. And then we're the home of the, we're the kind of fiscal and physical home of the Monarch Joint Venture. The Monarch Joint Venture is a collaborative effort of many different agencies and nonprofit organizations and universities that are working together to kind of coordinate monarch conservation efforts. So that our main conservation work is through the Monarch Joint Venture. So we do education, research, and conservation.
And both the Monarch Joint Venture and the Monarch Lab have great websites, so you can get lots of wonderful information, the latest news, etc. And it looks like you can also sign up for some updates too.
Yep, we have a lot of updates, and mm-hmm. we're pretty active in social media and newsletters. So if people want information in monarchs, we have a lot. It's mm-hmm. just monarchlab.org and monarchjointventure.org.
Okay. Karen, the population that does overwinter in California, how does that work? What's their timing look like?
Well, their timing is pretty similar. It's a little bit abbreviated. So they tend to leave the overwintering sites in California a little bit earlier than the ones in Mexico do. But they're actually in fairly similar microclimatic conditions. So they're along the coasts of California. We know that they've been going there, for well over 100 years. Of course, people weren't paying that much attention mm-hmm. to insects longer ago than that. But that population has gone to these overwintering sites along the coast. There are a few differences. The overwintering colonies are much smaller, where there might be hundreds of thousands of monarchs at a site in Mexico, there are thousands, mm-hmm. And sometimes fewer than a thousand mm-hmm. at sites along the California coast. And there are lots of sites along the coast. So it might be just a little tiny state park or even a few trees on a golf course. Some of the land is private. So it's not quite as structured as the sites in Mexico, because in Mexico they're going to mountaintops.
Okay.
And along the California coast there's a big long area that has kind of the right conditions for them.
So are those sites in California mostly protected or not?
I'm not sure of the exact percentage of them that are protected. Certainly the ones that are in state parks are protected. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I couldn't tell you if most of them are, just because there are dozens of them.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like a great opportunity for additional conservation. Get some people excited about purchasing some land. Just saying, listeners, if you're in California, you might want to look into that. Do monarchs occur anywhere else?
Well, actually, there are monarchs in many places throughout the world. We know from genetic work that monarchs are a North American species, so they're native to here. But there are monarchs actually that are in South America, so there are species that are down into Argentina and Chile, so pretty far down into South America. There are some close relatives of monarchs throughout kind of the middle of the Americas, so the northern part of South America and Central America and Southern United States. But monarchs have made their way into many other places throughout the world. So there are now monarchs, the species that we're talking about, in Hawaii, Australia, New Zealand, several other Pacific islands. Monarchs have been seen, and now there's actually a constant population of monarchs in southern Portugal and Spain.
Wow.
And throughout the Caribbean. So they've found their way. We don't know exactly how. Probably had to do with people moving them, because mm-hmm. a lot of these places don't have native milkweed. But somehow they're pretty much a world traveler now. What's really fascinating to me about all of these other populations of monarchs is that they really get to a place, and obviously their behavior has to change a lot. For example, monarchs in Hawaii don't need to go through this period of not breeding. So they get plopped down in a place that's completely different and just do the right thing there. So They don't have migrations. In Australia, they migrate in response to dry conditions, and they have to migrate in the opposite direction, obviously, because it's in the southern hemisphere. So they've really adapted well to all of these very different places.
Now, for those areas that you mentioned that don't have native milkweed, I mean, how did these monarchs persist?
Well, people have brought milkweed to places. So there are lots and lots of species of milkweed. Mm-hmm. There are some milkweed species that are native to Africa. And those have in some, that's the one that was first moved into Australia. But there have been species that have been brought from North America into Europe and North America into Hawaii. So they've, you know, people move plants around. That's one of the things we do is kind of homogenize our environment. And in some cases, we've moved things to allow monarchs to move into new areas.
So I probably most listeners will know that monarch caterpillars are obligate feeders on milkweed. But there are some troublesome plants that are in the milkweed family that seem to be quite threatening, like a black swallowwort in northern New York, for example. Have you done any research on those kinds of milkweed mimics?
So I personally haven't done that research, but it's something I've really followed, and it's very interesting. So we have milkweed. It used to be its own family. There used to be a family of plants called the Asclepiadaceae. Mm-hmm. But you know how the plant people kind of lump things together and split them apart.
Right.
So now milkweed plants have been moved into a different family, the same family as dogbane.
Mm-hmm.
But there are plants in what used to be the milkweed family that are closely enough related to milkweed species that monarch females think they're a host plant. So the black swallowwort is an example. They'll lay eggs on them, but the caterpillars can't eat them. So they're closely enough related that the females make that mistake. So that is a species that we're pretty concerned about. It's moving west. We, as far as I know, we don't have, I've never seen it, at least in Minnesota. It's fairly common, though, in Michigan. I've seen a lot of it along the East Coast, Massachusetts, New York. So, right, that is a problem for monarchs. But the good news is that there are 112, again, depending, more or less depending on if you're a lumper or a splitter, but there are well over 100 species of milkweed that monarchs can use that are native to North America.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very interesting to me that and these have a wide variety of phenotypes. So you know, some of them are really small. They have skinny leaves that look almost like pine needles, and some of them have great big leaves, and they vary in the in their leaf chemistry and the toughness of the leaves. But monarchs can eat them all. So you might have the same female monarch that emerges as an adult in Texas and will lay some eggs down there. But then as she moves north, she's exposed to different species of milkweed, and she recognizes and uses all of them. So I think that's pretty interesting that we think of them as specialists, but they really, there are lots of species that they have to recognize, and I think that's fascinating about their biology.
And I think just from an ecological perspective, trying to focus on originally native species that are appropriate to your site would be best practice, because there may be other insects that are utilizing these milkweeds, right?
Right. Yeah, I'm a big proponent of native plants. And I think that, so one of the things that we're really concerned about with milkweed species is now that people are becoming very interested in monarchs, in some cases, they think it's good to have milkweed always available for monarchs. Mm-hmm. So for example, there's a species of milkweed called Asclepias curassavica, or tropical milkweed. And that plant is grown by people in the southern United States. And the problem with that is it can be available to monarchs during times that native milkweed wouldn't be available. So that means that monarchs might use this. It could change their migratory behavior if milkweed is available at odd times of the year. Mm-hmm. It also means that monarchs can breed generation after generation on the same individual host plants, which can be a problem. We know that that allows diseases to build up on, mm-hmm. on the leaves of the plant. So it's better, we always say, to focus on species that are native to your area, because then they'll behave the way they're supposed mm-hmm. to behave and not kind of mess up monarch biology.
And some of your research has linked this protozoan parasite that I can't pronounce, OE. You can give the full name. tropical milkweed. And tell us about that.
Right. So it's everyone calls it OE, but its real name is Ophryocystis electroscura.
That's why I didn't say it.
Right. I always am a little reluctant to spell it, but I usually can spell it correctly. But anyway, it's a protozoan disease, and it's got this, it's specific to monarch butterflies. There's queen butterflies are closely related to mm-hmm. monarchs, and they have a parasite that is very, very similar. It might be the same species, we're not sure. But so this is a disease that on the adult butterfly is an inactive spore. So it's kind of looks like a tiny little football. The spore that's on the what we call the integument, or the outside skin of the adult monarch. And then when a female monarch lays eggs, those spores come off of her body onto her egg and onto the milkweed plants. And then when the caterpillar hatches out of the egg, the first thing it does is eats its little eggshell, and then it consumes the spores. And when the spores get into the gut of the caterpillar, they break open, or lice, because of the pH change, because it's more acidic in the caterpillar's gut. And then they go through, then they reproduce. So the spores are reproducing inside the caterpillar and the pupa. And then when the adult emerges, it might look perfectly fine. It might have what we call a low spore load, so it has a low level of infection. But in some ways, that's almost worse, because then it can transmit the spores to its own offspring. Mm-hmm. But if it gets a high enough load of these parasites, it can sometimes kill the caterpillar, or the adult monarch isn't able to emerge properly from its chrysalis or its mm-hmm. pupa. So it kind of, its skin has gotten messed up, and kind of, it stays stuck to the pupa casing. So it can be lethal. It can shorten the monarch's lifespan, or if it has a low load, it might just live like a normal adult, but then it can transmit it to its mm-hmm. own offspring. Mm-hmm. And if what we worry about with this tropical milkweed, or any other milkweed that's available for generation after generation, is that these spores can build up on the milkweed plant, so we get more and more caterpillars infected mm-hmm. with higher loads of the parasite.
And it's getting much easier now to source milkweed that is native to your region, and even locally grown, which is best practice. So really encourage listeners to go in that direction. I know I'm in New York, and in the Northeast, a lot of people use tropical milkweed as an annual plant. Hey, there are great native plants in containers, including milkweed. So
right.
We'll try to focus on that.
Mm-hmm. The only thing we have to watch out for is to make sure they're not treated with systemic insecticides.
So absolutely,
it's always a good idea to ask in a garden store if you're buying the plants, mm-hmm. If they've been treated, especially with these neonicotinoids, which are systemic yep. insecticides. They would be toxic to the caterpillar.
Mm-hmm. And an alternative would be obviously growing milkweed from seed, yep. but really putting the pressure on our garden centers and our nurseries, including native nurseries, to grow things organically.
Right.
Yep, absolutely. Now, we've talked a lot about monarchs, and you and I love monarchs, but why are monarchs important?
So that's, I think, a great question, and one that I obviously think about a lot. I mean, I run into a lot of people that care a lot about monarchs, and I think monarchs, if monarchs went extinct tomorrow, We probably wouldn't notice big sweeping ecosystem changes. They're not what we call a keystone species. They eat milkweed, but they don't control milkweed. It wouldn't be like kudzu or something with, you know, milkweed taking over the world. They have some specialist predators and parasites, but, you know, we wouldn't really care if OE went extinct in the world. But I think what is really important about monarchs is people care so much about them. And they're a real flagship species that they make people concerned about nature. When people conserve habitat for monarchs, they're conserving habitat for lots and lots of other species. So really, monarchs are like this perfect ambassador that engage people in the natural world and make them care. And as a conservation biologist, I think that one of the most important things we need to do is to get people to care. And that's where monarchs come in, because everybody that knows about them loves them, or, you know, maybe not everybody, but a lot of people do. So they're just this great ambassador flagship species.
I often refer to monarchs as kind of the tip of the ecological iceberg. There's so many things going on in our natural world that we should be thinking about and be better stewards in our landscape. So monarchs are great, great flagship.
Right. When monarchs aren't doing well, there's a lot of other things that we're not keeping track of that aren't doing well either.
And what can folks do to help monarchs?
So the great thing about monarchs in involving people is that because monarchs can live in so many different habitats, I mean, monarchs can live in pristine prairies, but they can also find a milkweed plant that's growing out of a crack in a sidewalk in a big city. So because of that, people really can make a big difference for monarchs. You know, actions done by people that don't have control over a lot of land. So what people can do, very importantly, is they can do what they can to increase available habitat for monarchs. And this can mean their own land, their backyards. It can mean a nature center in their hometown, a state park, their place of work, their place of worship, their kids' daycare center. Anywhere like that, they can work with other people to create habitat for monarchs. And what they just need is milkweed and nectar plants. So they need food for the caterpillars and food for the adult butterflies. But if people don't have access to habitat, there are still things that they can do. I'm a conservation biologist, so I'm a firm believer that we need to know a lot about the species we're trying to save. And with monarchs, we have all of these great citizen science projects that people can take part in. So they can track monarchs that they see in the spring or the fall, or they can report caterpillars that they see on their milkweed plants. There are people that raise monarchs to see, to measure disease levels and levels of parasites, so they can get involved in citizen science projects. We have a lot of information about different monarch citizen science projects on the Monarch Joint Venture website. People can also, a third thing they can do is educate other people. So I would just encourage anybody listening to this today to go out and talk to their neighbors, talk to their friends, give talks to Lions clubs or library groups or anyone that will listen to them, their neighbors. So educating other people about monarch biology. And finally, there are a lot of great organizations out there. And just like anything else, these organizations are working to raise funds to do the work that they do. So Monarch Joint Venture, Monarch Butterfly Fund, there are lots of organizations that are working to create and protect habitat in the United States. Would be the Monarch Joint Venture. And then in Mexico, there's an organization called the Monarch Butterfly Fund that's, that's working to help people in Mexico preserve the overwintering sites. So that's a fourth category. If they don't want to go out and get their hands dirty, they can just give money.
And, you know, I'm thinking of a fifth thing, too, is to become an advocate for better agricultural practices. So you've done a lot of work on, I think you may have been one of the first people to comment on Roundup Ready crops. So tell us about that, especially for listeners that don't understand that connection.
Yeah. So Fortuitously, way back in 2000, people were very concerned about the potential impacts of BT corn on monarchs. So BT corn is corn that has a pesticide. It's a genetically modified corn. It produces toxic pollen, mm-hmm. and it's meant to protect the corn from corn borers, which are moths, where the caterpillars eat the corn plants. But people were worried about the potential impacts of this on monarchs because the pollen is toxic. Mm-hmm. The pollen can blow off of the corn plants and onto milkweed plants. So in the year 2000, I and several colleagues throughout the United States and even into Canada went into hundreds of milkweed of cornfields and looked for milkweed mm-hmm. growing in these cornfields and looked for monarchs on the milkweed. And what we found was that there was a lot of milkweed in corn, and we also looked in soybean fields and corn and soybean fields, and that monarchs were using this. And when we looked at the density of the milkweed in the corn and soybean fields and just the vast acreage that was covered with corn and soybean fields, we calculated that most of the monarchs in the eastern part of North America came from corn and soybean fields. And then what happened shortly after that is farmers started growing another genetically modified first soybeans and then corn. And these are crops that are what we call, like you said, Roundup ready. So these are crops that themselves are resistant to Roundup. So the farmers could spray Roundup into these fields. It killed all of the weeds, including the milkweed, but didn't kill the crops. So gradually from 2000, when we did this study until now, we now have over 90% of corn and soybean fields in this country are Roundup ready and thus being sprayed with Roundup and not including any milkweed anymore. So what that means is monarchs lost most of the habitat that they were using. We're not going to probably change a lot of these agricultural practices, at least not quickly enough for monarchs. So what that means is we need to replace that lost habitat with other habitat.
Mm-hmm.
But we need to understand the magnitude of the problem before we can start to solve it. So that's why I said it was fortuitous that we went into those cornfields mm-hmm. and soybean fields for a completely different reason 16 years ago. So now we have this baseline, and we know that's the problem we need mm-hmm. to address.
I think this is very important because we often think of things like species decline as very discrete things, and really nature is so interconnected. We're just living in a huge food web, aren't we?
Right. Lots of things going on. And, mm-hmm. you know, I think that I often talk about this as a problem with many causes. So we've got the loss of milkweed from agricultural fields. We've got the climate is changing. We've got deforestation and the Mexican overwintering sites. There are lots of things happening to monarchs. And, you know, we need to understand all of those things and do what we can to address them. Mm-hmm.
Well, you've just given us so much wonderful information today. Dr. Karen Oberhauser from the University of Minnesota, please, listeners, take a look at monarchlab.org and monarchjointventure.org and follow Dr. Oberhauser's work. Karen, thank you so much for being a guest today.
Thank you. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you.
This is Kim Eierman from EcoBeneficial. Thanks for watching. For more useful tips, please visit www.ecobeneficial.com.